In the Deadwood Gold Rush of the 1870s and 1880s, miners and even unskilled laborers could prosper or not, depending on luck, stamina, and common sense, or the lack of it. But skilled people with the drive and energy to start businesses and provide the services that a boomtown needs were bound to prosper in a business environment in which some competitors rose to the top and others were sent packing. For lawyers, Deadwood was the motherlode. Capable attorneys like Henry Frawley built thriving firms that handled everything from land claims and lawsuits to divorces and criminal trials. Henry Frawley's job was to look after the interests of his clients, but the job also provided connections and information that helped him make a lot of money on investments. And unlike some of Deadwood's prosperous pioneers whose wealth came and went in the same way they did, Frawley's legacy of investment and commerce lives on in the Northern Black Hills. The story begins and continues with the land. At the peak of the gold rush, it's estimated that around 10,000 newcomers crowded Deadwood Gulch and the surrounding hills. Among them were three men who planned to do what was called mining the miners. They arrived in Deadwood in 1877, reportedly on the same wagon train out of Bismarck. W.E. Adams would establish a highly profitable grocery business. John Hunter arrived with a portable sawmill and immediately began making money in lumber. The third was Patrick Henry Frawley, who may have been born in New York, but was more likely born in Ireland in about 1848. It's known that his parents, Thomas and Honora Frawley, immigrated to the U.S. in 1849. Henry was the eldest of nine siblings. He grew up and attended schools in rural Dane County, Wisconsin, and in Madison.
My grandfather, Henry Frawley, was a young man who graduated from law school, University of Wisconsin, in 1876, and a year later, summer of 77, he came to Deadwood to set up a law practice. The territory had just opened up to settlement then. And as his law practice began to grow and develop, he wanted to buy some land and develop a ranch.
He bought land during the 1880s, but hadn't yet acquired the big cattle ranch he'd been dreaming of. In 1890, his fortunes took a new turn in the Centennial Valley, just east of Spearfish.
Centennial Valley was named by a group of men from Ames, Iowa, who came here in 1876 and thus named it Centennial Valley or Centennial Prairie. They're interchangeable, in honor of our country's 100th birthday.
There was enough traffic through the valley to support a livery and hotel. But plans for a town were dashed when the Postal Service chose another route for the mail to Deadwood and Lead. Injury followed insult when a prairie fire burned the hotel and everything else to the ground. Henry Frawley purchased the land and became a neighbor to some dozen homesteading families already in the valley, including one James Anderson.
The Andersons were Danish immigrants who already were well established in Yankton, South Dakota, and James Anderson was a Dakota Territory legislator. He came out in 1876 and found this property, now known as the James Anderson Dairy Ranch, and staked his claim, and then in 1877 brought out his wife Catherine and his seven-year-old daughter Christina. Christina had the kind of nickname, she was the jewel of the valley.
And they established a pioneer dairy ranch and started up in the dairy business.
Henry Frawley would have been in the same community working as a business person in the Deadwood community with James Anderson for approximately 13 years.
13 years leading up to 1890, when Henry Frawley, about 40 years old, married Christina Anderson, age 19. Henry and Christina Frawley expanded their ranch during the 1890s, buying up failing or failed homesteads one by one.
There was a lot of hardship and a lot of heartache, you know, because most of the people who came were farmers, or as they were referred to as sodbusters, and they learned the hard way that this climate and area was ill-suited for farming, especially with smaller tracts like 160 acres.
The Frawley story, so far, had been about the road to prosperity on the frontier. But in the late 1910s, the Frawley's road got a lot rougher. Henry Frawley had invested in a gold mine and lost a lot of money when it did not produce as expected. Some of the money was his, but a lot of it was borrowed. To stay afloat, he had to take a loan from John Laffey, his former law partner who was now living back east. Frawley seems to have broken under the weight of his debt and obligations. He suffered a nervous breakdown in 1920 and checked into the Green Gables Sanitarium in Lincoln, Nebraska. Now in his 70s, he somehow kept his law practice going until at least 1925. At some point, he returned to Green Gables for good, and that's where he died in 1927. He'd asked to have his body taken to Wisconsin, presumably for burial in the Frawley family plot in Dane County. Death notices and obituaries note that request, but oddly, no one has been able to locate any record of the body being transported, and as of 2017, the location of Frawley's burial remains a mystery.